If you ask people, what words do they associate with evolution? One of the key words that often comes up is chance, randomness. Molecular and cell biology is what I was trained in, and I've always had a struggle trying to reconcile sort of what you see in science textbooks, particularly around evolution, where we're just sort of a meaningless twig on the evolutionary tree. We're in some cosmic backwater where we have no purpose or meaning, with that sense that there is purpose in my life. I think everybody that thinks about evolution brings philosophical baggage with them. There's always people that say evolution is just random. You know, the universe is just random. It's just atoms colliding in the void, and this is what came out. And one of the questions I like to ask them is, why does evolution work at all? For life to evolve, there has to be a huge amount of order. There's the order in the cell, then there's the order in the molecules, then the order in the elements, and the order in the subatomic forces and particles. Each level, that order becomes more symmetrical as you go down. If you don't have that order, evolution doesn't get off the ground. That order dictates, to some extent, what's going to work in evolution. And I think the most robust example of that is at the level of proteins. Proteins are fundamental to the structure of, you see, every organism. And proteins are made of amino acids, and they fold into a protein. There's, in a sense, an infinite possible number of combinations of strings of amino acids, these little balls you can put together. There's 20 of them that are biologically relevant. But anytime you string together proteins and you put them into like the aqueous environment of the cell, if they fold, they fold into only two really stable structures. They're called alpha helices and beta sheets. So if evolution were to run again and you had proteins, they would still fold into alpha helices and beta sheets, because that's what the chemistry and physics dictates, right? And once you have alpha helices and beta sheets, there's only a certain number of ways you can combine those. There's an order that the physics and chemistry sort of pushes evolution to, and evolution just sort of finds that order that exists because of the physics and chemistry. There's certain things that evolution is going to be able to produce via natural selection, and there's certain things that's not going to be able to produce. And there's certain things that are so robust because of the underlying chemistry and physics that evolution might produce over and over again. And this is the idea of convergence. Certain structures that evolve multiple times in independent lineages. And what that suggests is that this underlying structure and order dictates certain solutions. So for example, the camera-like eye that humans have, that structure has evolved at least 6 to 7 times in different lineages. In certain snails, you find it in certain cephalopods, you find it in humans. Light is one of those things. The wavelengths of light and the different intensities and energy levels, that's fixed. So if you reran evolution multiple times with this structure, light is always going to be light. And so if you want to take advantage of it, either it's absorbing the energy of light with chloroplasts or by sensing the light to be able to have vision, you're gonna have to be able to respond to the same type of wavelengths of light. You're gonna have to be able to focus it. Now, the way it finds it and the path that it gets there is gonna be a lot of chance things. You know, the timing is gonna be off, but it's gonna get to certain solutions because that's the way to harness light. Another example of convergence would be powered flight. So you see powered flight evolving multiple times in the mammals. You see it evolving in the reptiles, modern birds. You see it evolving in insects, echolocation. That's evolved multiple times in different lineages. You see this level of convergence throughout evolution. I think one of the more fascinating examples of that is the kiwi bird in New Zealand. And so there are no mammals that are native to New Zealand, but the kiwi bird looks like a mammal. It's like a bird that is sort of evolving to take over that mammal niche. So it doesn't, you know, lay a bunch of eggs like most birds. Its feathers look like hair. It is nocturnal, and it behaves more like a small rodent. Sort of developing and evolving that mammal-like behavior because there's a niche there. That's a good way of making a living. There's certain things that are going to work based on the physics and the chemistry and so forth. And that chance is sort of a good algorithm to sort through and get you to those islands that work of possibility. But those possibilities and what's going to work, those flow from the way the universe is structured. But to say evolution is just chance misses, I think, the most beautiful, most important aspects of how evolution works. When you look at evolution and see that evolution is built upon a bed of order and is dependent upon that order to function at all, and that order helps direct evolution, that then raises certain questions that are sort of amenable to seeing purpose in nature. And the question is, why is there order? Why do we live in an ordered universe when there's many, many other possibilities? And science can't answer that because there's no scientific experiment to run. Science has certain questions that it's really good at answering. Science can explain the different forces in nature and the different particles. And so people are awed by the power of science, so they assume science can answer philosophical questions that science can't answer. And it's common in science, where scientists will argue that science shows that there is no purpose. And it's important to recognize that anytime someone says that, they're not speaking for science. They're not speaking scientifically anymore, which is the great irony there. As a scientist, I think every day when I leave the lab, you know, I have sort of an appreciation for the fact that I've been given the opportunity to be able to peer in behind the veil of nature and see how things work. Even on a small scale, nature is huge and vast. There's a small little window that I get to look through to understand how it works and appreciate that order and that beauty. And that mystery and that awe and that joy of discovery keeps you humble because you have an appreciation for what little we really do know. And it leads you to be less dogmatic in your conclusions. The universe is filled with order from top to bottom. And it's a beautiful order, and not only is it beautiful, it's an order that we can actually comprehend. And it's almost as if we have been made to be able to comprehend that order in the universe, to be able to contemplate it so that we can see maybe that purpose behind it.